Hello and welcome to a list of some of our most popular Unity tips. As you might be aware, we are regularly posting under the weekly Unity Tips hashtag to share our knowledge with the community. Over the last 2 years, we did not miss a single week. And today, we want to give you a list of 10 of our most popular tips. Let us start with a simple tip. You can use the combination of Shift, Alt, and A to enable or disable an object in your hierarchy. This might sound like not much at all, but it may save you a few meters of moving your mouse each day, and aren't we all happy about even the smallest of optimizations? The next one is a little bit more complex, and a lot of developers might not even know that it exists. We are talking about the infamous CS0649 warning that you will get in some cases. This warning is triggered if you use an uninitialized private field which never gets a value assigned. This can happen a lot in Unity if you use private fields with the serialize field attribute to make them visible in the inspector. In newer versions of Unity, you might not see this warning and wonder why Visual Studio still complains. This is because a checkbox was added to the project settings to suppress common warnings like CS0649 and CS0169. In larger projects, you might still want to see these in cases where they are correctly given, but you don't want to drown in a flood of them. Luckily, there are a number of ways to get rid of them. The first option is to disable them in the project settings, but this is only an option in newer versions of Unity. The second option is to explicitly disable the warning right at the position where it will be triggered. But this will add a lot of additional lines of code to your scripts. The third option is to disable the warning for the whole project by placing a file with the name csc.rsp in your assets folder. The file needs to have the content -no1:0649. All these options have the same problem in common. They only hide the warning, they do not solve the issue. And that is where the fourth, and in our eyes the recommended solution, comes in. By assigning the default value to the field, you will get rid of the warning. Keep in mind that this works in scripts using C# 7.1 and later. With our next tip, we will get back to something a little bit simpler, but also very handy. The conversion of degrees to radians is pretty simple. Multiply the degree value by pi divided by 180. This is nothing too complicated, but even here we can optimize a little bit. Did you know that the mathf library has a constant defined especially for this? You can simply multiply your degree value by mathf.deactorad. And there is even another constant for the other way around, mathf.radToDeck. Let us continue with something not too different from the last tip. The random class has three very useful methods, which come in handy very often. The first one is random.insideUnitCircle. The second one is random.onUnitSphere. The third one is similar to the second, but instead of a point on the sphere, it returns a point inside it. These will give you exactly what their names are promising. A point inside a circle with the radius 1, or a point on or inside a sphere with the radius of 1. With these two, we can build some very useful methods, which will give us points either on a circle of a given radius or on a sphere of a given radius. The next tip will again be a little bit more complicated. With extension methods, you can add functionality specific to a particular enum type. For a game project, we built a square tile system and added methods to help us work with the neighboring tiles. This made it a lot easier to implement all of our movement and side checks. Check out the code and maybe you will find some use for it in your own projects. Our tips have all been in the realm of programming up until now, so let us look at something for the artists. Using Volumetrics is a great way to enhance the look of any scene, but it usually comes with quite a high impact on performance if it's done in the correct way. If you only needed to set some nice highlights in your environment, there's a cheap way to fake the same effect without much costs. You can use simple line renderers with a texture to make some light shafts in your scene. Check it out in this scene from our game Beam. We used this effect in a few places in the second chapter and it really adds to the visual appeal. If you use a lot of objects to help you debugging your game, it might be a chore to disable or delete them one by one before building a version. Fortunately, Unity comes with a built-in tag for exactly this purpose. You can just tag the object as editor only. The drawback is that this only works for scene objects and will not apply to objects that you spawned from a script, which were from prefabs with the same tag. The tag applies to both development and release builds. Did you know that you can add a reset method to a component? It can be used to fill in a set of standard values and may save you a lot of drag and drops. Did you ever notice something like this in your projects? Let us take a closer look and slow it down frame by frame. As you can see, one of the objects collides with the wall and the other one doesn't. This happens because one of them is set to discrete collision detection and the other one is set to continuous collision detection. Discrete collision detection only checks for collisions in fixed intervals. If the object is moving too fast, it will be in front of the potential collider in one step and behind it in the next step. The collision will then be missed. If you have to work with fast-moving objects, consider enabling continuous collision detection. If it is switched on, the object will be swept along the path between steps to see if it would have hit something in the process. Like most useful things, this comes with some computational costs, and you should only enable it if you need it. Let us finish our current list with another short one. This one has been mentioned many times over and over and still manages to show up in a lot of projects. If used sparingly, it might not be a problem, but for high-frequency code, this should be avoided at all costs. Profiling shows a difference of about 50% in favor of GameObject.CompareTag above a simple string comparison with GameObject.Tag. As we said before, this is not a huge problem if you use this on a handful of components and only in methods that are called once or twice. But if this is used in the update or something similar, it will quickly add up and might evolve into a problem. So please use CompareTag wherever possible. This will be all for today. If your favorite Unity tip was not in our list, or if you have something that helped you a lot, please leave a comment below. Also, if you would like to see more of our tips, you can check out our Twitter account @BinaryImpactG. If you want to see more tips in video form, please tell us in the comments. To be up to date with all of our content, consider subscribing to our channel. Thank you for your time and see you in the next video.